Did you want to do Jacob first, or did you want to do other one first?
Well, first, let me tell you what I've been getting up to.
Yeah, go for it.
One, I got some fucking edibles in the mail. Starting out on a low dose because I've heard these fellas can be lethal.
I've had a horrible, horrible experience. Well, I've had two horrible experiences with edibles. Because with alcohol and things like that, there's a lot of valid reasons to hate alcohol. With alcohol, you know exactly how much you're putting into your system most of the time if you do it right. Weed is a vehicle for putting horrible things into your body. That can't kill you for the most part, but it can. There's less of a direct feedback with it,
Yeah. So I'm being very judicious with dosage. And also
Dude, it's way better to do too little at first.
just in case there are just some fucked up drug interactions I'm not aware of.
That happens too. I'm pretty sure the really bad crisis that I had with one was partially because I was just getting on antidepressants and it reacted poorly with that. But
I've also been playing so much fucking Celeste.
yes.
Celeste, I've be because everyone wants to know my take on Strawberry Jam, because I released my video on Spring Collab 5 days after Strawberry Jam came out.
You've been having shit luck with that, I'm not gonna lie.
And like playing through Strawberry Jam has. The first part of it, at least, is like been the most fucking demoralizing experience ever. Because they made just the same mistakes, like all of them that I talked about in the video, except like worse in some cases. Like,
Nice.
you know how that video like talks about like how the expert lobby is in this like tense middle ground between like where the mechanical difficulty is becoming like so tight and constrained that I have to find like ways to keep it interesting and engaging and have you participate in the levels instead of just watching a movie. Like how that was just such a big part of the video, and I was like, oh, like the expert lobby is where this relationship is most strained. Strawberry Jam, in a daring feat, moved this conflict to the fucking intermediate lobby. So way earlier, we end up getting levels that are so like scripted and like automatic almost. It's because like they're trying to court players of the actual game. Like that's the thing. Like the other thing I wish I'd gotten my video out earlier so that they knew that they're fucking fan fiction writers and they're not making more content for the game. Like that's the other that's that's It has like it's almost allergic to jank. Like Spring Collab might have been like jank in some places and like actively kind of unfinished in others, but like Strawberry Jam is like butter smooth all the time, and like even as there's lots of different ideas, they kind of end up feeling the same anyways. There are exceptions. I would actually recommend like if you're new to Celeste modding playing just the beginner lobby, 'cause like that's fun. That's like fun and varied. Intermediate lobby less recommended because there it's kind of like the meta takes hold at that point. And I can't imagine it being appealing to someone who like is hasn't already drank the Kool-Aid. Okay, here's the difference. Beginner lobby is challenging for newcomers, like it's for beginners. The intermediate lobby feels more like it's the easy for expert players lobby. It's like meant to be a relaxing reprieve for people who are fucking insane at the game, like me. That's the difference.
Gotcha.
It's getting better, and there's like exception. It's exceptions everywhere, but especially now that I'm like venturing more into the prickly skill ceiling. Like there's more creative freedom, especially like middle upper expert lobby.
It
But
feels I've
yes.
played like comparatively, like next to nothing of Celeste compared to you, but like for a game that's going for kind of a Kaizo thing, of kind of like an elevated Kaizo mentality. It feels weird to have a fan modding scene that is kind of resistant to that. Because Kaizo is all jank, and that's what makes it cool. And Celeste is definitely different from that, but it also feels like
They
the mechanics that they have. Go.
sanded out they've sanded off the small amount of jank that is present in the original game. Like, it made me yearn for the comparative grit and texture of fucking Celeste. Like Celeste, like it kind of made me like think, like, what do I even like about Celeste?
Celeste
I like
brought
the
me back to myself.
I like it feels nice to play, but it also feels like it's all part of a place, and all the level geometry is kind of important, and also it's like improvisatory. It never feels like you're being directly prompted to use your dash in a certain way. In modded levels, there's always like a certain correct way to do it, even in the easier levels. But to wrap this up, there are exceptions. Paint from the beginner lobby is a fucking miracle. I don't know how that map exists. It looks beautiful, but also it's like functional just through like fucking just astounding use of contrast and value. It has that like Celeste magic where it never feels like there's a specific correct place to use your dash. It's like all improvisatory and exploratory and a little challenging. It's so good. It's incredibly good. I love Undergrowth. I love the lab. Okay, the expert lobby like brought in the heavy hitters. Fall Fortress, great. Summit Downside is just getting over it in Celeste.
You
So
linked me
it's
a
it's
video of that one. Like, yeah, that was today.
so 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 that's just like it's targeted at me
That's
specifically.
bait.
Like Patty bait.
It's hard. Yeah, it's one of the things where it's like it's hard to say it's your favorite because it was just kind of made for you. It's
Yeah, like it's like redundant to say it's my favorite.
like, yeah, sure, yeah, this is the best one.
Like that and Undergrowth also felt kind of like targeted. But Boat Knife is an arts and culture podcast.
Yeah.
I didn't intend for that to go on so long.
It's okay. No, I don't care.
The Celeste modding
What I
scene has entered its coffee shop AU phase where the fan fiction is developing its own tropes.
They're entering the Smash Bros. Mansion, as it were.
Yes.
I'm fine. I think the intro's going long is good. Because, like, you know, the intro music has kind of a jump scare like quality. So the longer that we hold that out, the more tension that builds up.
So, Patrick,
Yeah.
I want to do puzzle first.
Okay, I also want to do puzzle first. Okay. I forget if I mentioned this at all in the one where we had to speed record something else and go over something else because I did a
Yeah,
fucky wucky.
they have heard about the fucky wucky, and
Okay,
we
they
can
did hear about
update,
the fucky
and we
wucky.
can also like give props to the hero that helped us out with this.
Yes, no, yeah, give ups, give big ups.
Last time, Patrick wanted me to watch this movie called Puzzle, like this weird, unheard of chick flick about
Yeah.
an autistic woman.
The credentials are very important for this one. I saw this shit in like junior year of high school in like a major AMC theater on a whim with a friend because nothing else at the theater looked interesting. And I've never heard anyone else talk about it anywhere else after I watched it. And we found out that there is a good reason for that because it is a remake of an Argentinian film called The Puzzle.
So
I
we're
yeah.
probably gonna call it like Argentine Puzzle and US Puzzle.
Yeah.
And Argentine Puzzle was like Puzzle was hard to track down. Argentine Puzzle was nearly impossible until a friend of mine named Sam, any all pronouns, she she got me she got me on this like this streaming platform where you can share files called Plex. Baby. Fucking Plex.
Plex is good.
It is good. And like he got like the DVD shipped in from fucking Australia or something.
Yeah, where do they live?
Oh, they live near me.
Ooh, okay.
We've like met.
Nice. Nice. So they just committed a lot to it. It's not like they left in Argentina. Okay. Thank you, Sam.
So now like we got to see Argentine Puzzle.
Yeah. It was disappointing at first when I found that out, but once I realized it would probably be a pretty good opportunity to have a case study between like a remake and an original version of a foreign film that's being remade for an American audience, because like there really no baggage with Puzzle, you know?
And they're both solid.
Yeah. They're like, on top of it being something that's relatively unheard of, it's something that's good. It's something where it's like there's interesting qualities with both ones, and it probably did need to be remade to some extent.
Which one do you prefer?
I think I prefer the original, mostly because of the ending.
Me too.
Yeah, but
we'll get into that.
Yeah, we'll get into it. There's a lot about Turtletop's adaptation that feels really welcome. There's a lot of places where it does improve over the original. It's really interesting.
It is. Yeah. Watching like the original a second time, like knowing kind of what I was like, why it was different, and like the kind of different goals it had, I bumped that up to a 9.
Damn. Yeah.
That's a 9, and I think US Puzzle is like a strong 7.
Yeah. No, that's fair. That's fair. Let's get into the original then. This was like late end of like the like 2010s like household drama boom that was kind of happening. This was directed by a woman named Natalia Smirnoff. I have not seen anything else from her, but I do want to now. It stars Maria Onetto, who I have seen in one other film. She was the leading actor in a movie called The Headless Woman that I watched also kind of recently, incidentally. Fucking fantastic in that.
I know The Headless Woman as I found it in the list, like, if you like male-directed movie, you might like female-directed movie, across from Caché.
It's... yeah. Okay. I think you'd fuck with The Headless Woman a lot, actually. I've seen two movies by that director. She's fucking great. I've seen La Cienaga and The Headless Woman. Both of those kicked my ass really hard. Highly recommended. That's relevant here because Maria plays kind of a very similar character between both of those movies. It seems like she gets cast a lot in these kind of like domestic roles with a lot of baggage. The basic plot of the film is a housewife has been married for a number of years at this point. Both versions of the film open with her doing a lot of preparation for a birthday party. It's a really incredible opening scene. She's doing a lot of preparation for a birthday party. We get these scenes of her and of the rest of her family, and most notably her husband, celebrating this party. And it's only at the end that she's running around baking food and cooking things and is like preoccupied for the entire night, and only at the end she bring the cake out, and it's revealed that it was her birthday party and not her husband's.
Incredibly good.
It's so good. So efficient. So good. Like
interesting. Like both films start in exactly the same way. They reveal this information slightly differently. Like the original, not difference in cinematography, like the original like begins in like close-ups, fragmented like bits of this work, and like it pulls away gradually because it's a film that deals a lot in close-ups and like very claustrophobic scenes.
Lots of close shots of her face, yeah.
And it like pulls away, like initially you don't even know like she's preparing for a party. You don't even really know what she's doing because like it's kind of abstract.
Mm-hmm.
And then like we kind of surface into it. US Puzzle has her far away and silhouetted by light in shadow, like she's indistinct, hazy, in the background of her own party.
And it's definitely like a North American Christian film in a way that Original Puzzle is not.
And I think that's another. That's what's fun about these movies, because they're both solid. It lets me like think very happily about like the kind of dualism between them.
Yeah, yeah. How
do they complement each other?
How do they complement each other?
What does each director choose to dwell on?
Mm-hmm.
Because the directors have like different preferences, as like I think different ideas as to what the story is really about.
Mm-hmm.
But we can continue.
The crucial thing with the birthday party is that one of the birthday gifts that she gets is a jigsaw puzzle, it's something that she has no experience with. It's kind of, you know, across both cultures, it's kind of a type of gift that, you know, if you don't really know what to get for somebody, you could get them a puzzle and they'll probably be pretty happy with it. It's a thing to do. It's something to do passively in the background. She takes to it very actively. It's a pretty large puzzle. It's a 1,000-piece puzzle that she's able to complete in one day. Her method for solving is not super conventional. One thing that the American version definitely has over the Argentinian version is that we do get some very nice shots, like a lot more nice pulled out shots of the puzzle being done, which I like. Getting big cute overhead shots of all of the pieces coming together. It makes my brain happy.
The act of solving a puzzle is a lot more sensual.
Yeah. There's a lot of shots of hands running across the pieces, especially in the American version.
Because the US version falls on like very strongly on like the real puzzle being love.
Yeah.
So it makes sense.
That's one of the things that concerned me about the US version. That was like the one big hang up I had after I watched it, was like the puzzle piece being used as kind of a stand-in for, if not autism, some kind of more general neurotic disorder, because the puzzle piece has a very specific connotation with autism in America. But learning that that is like pretty much the big thing that was lifted directly from the original version makes me feel a lot better about it being used as a stand-in for that, because I don't think that Autism Speaks really has the same presence down there that it does up here, you know?
Although, I think Turtle Tub saw an autism parable in this story and decided to embellish it.
He is a lot more confrontational about it being an autism thing. She has a lot more autistic girl swag. Kelly MacDonald plays the leading woman in the American version of Puzzle. You might know her as the main guy's wife in No Country for Old Men. She was Brave in Brave, and she was the victim of cancel culture in that one Black Mirror episode. It's not like this is the first one where. her performance is a lot more in line with like there's a lot more focus on the economy in the original version of Puzzle.
She was brave.
She was brave. She does not have a Scottish accent in this. I don't know if she is Scottish. She might be faking for clout.
What was the entire? I did not catch any of that.
She the original version of Puzzle focuses a lot more on like housework as an economical thing, and how that translates into like a psychological state. Whereas Puzzle 2018, she's given a lot more agency in that version. She's given a lot more options on what she wants to do.
It's more of a character study.
Yeah,
it's
more about her. Yeah,
like that's the big difference. Like, Argentine Puzzle is like a feminist parable. It's about
it's about
like it's about like one. Like it makes sense for her to be kind of boring and passive because it's about like a housewife discovering an interest for the first time in her life after being like a housewife for years and years.
Mm-hmm.
So it ends up like kind of being more about her being trapped by her circumstances. US Puzzle is more interested in giving its main character weird, twisty, uncomfortable choices.
Mm-hmm.
She is more of an active participant in it. It is more. Let's talk about cucking.
The main crux of the plot. After she gets the puzzle, she starts to get really into it. Her husband is kind of confused by it. She tracks down where the puzzle was purchased from, and was purchased from like a. In both versions, she lives in more of like a suburban area and buses out towards kind of a major metropolitan area where you could probably reasonably have a puzzle store that does not get immediately drilled into the ground. While she is there buying things, she sees like a tack board up that is inviting people to contact somebody to... double in a puzzle assembly tournament. From there, that kind of spirals into her getting into contact with a new man. It's in both cases, there's an immediate erotic element of the former partner was like either his wife or like a former lover. So she's immediately taking the place of this missing bride. The
American version. Another adaptational flourish.
Yeah.
Another adaptational flourish is that when Agnes, which is her name in the US version, mm-hmm. when she happens upon this little ad with the flyers, it says seeking a puzzle partner, and she does not initially know that it means like for a competition. She thinks that she definitely thinks he's just like looking for like a puzzle companion.
Yeah.
Like, yeah. Oh, there's someone who wants someone to do puzzles with.
Yeah, he does like a romantic surprise thing on her where he doesn't tell her where she's going and takes her to a local puzzle tournament, and she has a horrible time there. And that's kind of a fun scene of being like, I'm sorry, I shouldn't have done this.
She's so autistic.
So autistic. That's like the first big setting boundaries scene with that sort of thing.
That she spends the whole scene just visibly shaken by the outing just not going the way she was expecting it to.
Yeah, like, I don't want to be here. I'm going to leave from here.
Like, it's every scene. Like, mm-hmm. every scene has something that was like, oh yeah, like mm-hmm. like she looks at her husband and he's like, oh, you're giving me that look, and she says like, there was no look.
The husband. That's something that's interesting between the versions that I want to dig more into later. I want to drill down on the sexy doctor in both versions for now. One thing that is consistent through both versions that I didn't expect to be consistent at first was the doctor in the American version is an Indian dude. And one of the big like material things that is important about that is he has like a housemaid, like a house servant woman who makes him tea, and he's able to call to bring him tea throughout the day. That is also present in the Argentinian version. I just kind of figured in that version that that was something like something that was more normal for rich people there to have on hand.
That's a lot. There's a lot of things that I was surprised to also be in the original. Like the original also has a vegan bitch in it.
It does have a vegan bitch. There, it's so that's the one that goes the other way. Is like there is like a like an SJW Buddhist girl who the fail son in the family in both versions is dating, and he's like, I want to go. Yeah, I don't know. I'm just kind of gonna. Take the money that you guys are giving me. I think I'm just gonna kind of vibe for a year.
Go to Tibet with my with my like vegan bitch girlfriend.
It's so funny. The housemaid though is very important because I was wondering why that was there both times, and the thing I arrived at was like, that is an assurance that she would not have to spend her time doing housework more than she wanted to, because there are a lot of scenes where, you know, she gets the tea call, he calls the servant woman in for tea and brings them tea, and she's kind of like, well, no, I could just make tea real quick. Like, there is an element where she does kind of enjoy doing the work. She might not enjoy like the situation that she is in.
It's because like she's autistic as shit and,
yeah,
like,
no,
like she,
it's,
she craves routine. Like it's, that, like, it's that's like the read I got from specifically the US version of her, is that she was coasting, like just kind of living as comfortably as possible, doing like chores every day just because it was the same thing all the time, and like that's why she's the perfect housewife.
Yeah, the housewife is the most socially acceptable form of neurosis in countries that are living under the capitalist system.
When your puppy boyfriend wants to be a like a housewife, but he can't.
Shut the fuck up! Shut up! Shut up! Shut up! Shut up!
I think the big difference between Argentine Puzzle and U.S. Puzzle is that is the way cheating is employed.
Yes, it's a lot more explicitly erotic in the American version. It's something where she ultimately feels it's that again, playing into the economic thing, it's the conflicting thing with capitalism, where it's like she's given more options but she is ultimately more trapped in the American version. It's spooky the way that it progresses, because in the original version, the main arc with the movie is it kind of escalating and escalating, the husband getting slightly more skeeved out by it, but it ultimately cuts off before she is able to make a huge decision in the first place. Like, the husband doesn't really find out that like she's lying about where she's going every day, whenever she goes to meet up with her puzzle partner. It's left with she wins the puzzle tournament that they were training for. They've kissed once. It's implied that if she goes with him, there it will progress into something larger. But ultimately, she's left with a plane ticket that she hides amongst her other things. She pushes away from the puzzle partner at first, but it's left in this place where she could do a number of things from here. The last shot of the film is this shot of her just kind of lying, sitting, reclining in a field, as in front of a bright open sky, as she kind of looks around and has like a little snack.
In Argentine Puzzle, the puzzle meister and the puzzling hobby is sort of framed as this flowery, wistful life that could have been. And the movie is kind of about her realizing that she's trapped. She can't go any further with this man. She has to. They win the puzzle competition. They kiss. They maybe have sex as well. But like she has to say goodbye. And there's this fucking heartbreaking shot of her just like walking down the street crying.
A spectacular scene.
Incredible.
Such a good scene. There's so much good directing in that version. Ugh.
And in US Puzzle, it's way more about that moment, like the cheating, because I think like
it's so scandalous. It's
it's incredibly it's the
okay, off the top, the husband is shittier in the US version.
He is so much shittier. Like, that's another thing. Like, I expected the US version to have, like, the nicer husband.
Yeah, me too. That's honestly kind of how I remembered it. I, like, straight up did remember that he, like, threatens to beat her at one point. It's like, he's a lot more emotionally available tech in the sense that, like, he talks to people more, but, I didn't believe a single thing he said throughout the entire movie.
I don't think he
fundamentally changed at all.
They linger a lot. Okay, like here's the other thing that makes me like Argentine Puzzle a little bit more. It is so tight. It is a spry 80-minute film.
87 minutes in and out. Exactly what I wanted. Yep.
U.S. Puzzle is 20 minutes longer, and I feel it. Like, like there's a subplot about like how they're thinking of like selling their land so that the kids can go to college. And both movies have a scene where like they go there one more time to reminisce. And you might have like missed it in the original because it's just one shot. Like there's just one shot of them like looking.
Yeah, I straight up didn't know about it until you told me.
In the remake, there's like a whole scene like, oh, they're fishing together. Oh, they're sleeping under the stars together.
Oh.
Like, oh, there's a root in her back and she's uncomfortable. So her beautiful husband, like beautiful, beautiful man, says
the incredible fat fuck. They casted an incredible fat fuck for that role. I'm not sure who that guy is.
He's like, oh, let's switch places. And he's like, oh, ow, there is a root there. And there's just like 2 feet of bed of 2 feet of futon that they can both roll over. Like they can both. They can clearly just both roll over, Mark.
Yeah.
Why did you write that? So like stuff like that. Like the movie is like a lot fattier, and I think like that's what you were remembering, like when you kind of remembered the husband being a bit.
I got a little like, cum-brained with it.
Yeah, for sure. Because he is a beautiful man.
He's so gorgeous. He was in After Earth too. That's funny.
Argentine Puzzle's husband is nice. He's loving. There's like some pretty like stunning sex scenes with them, which Mark left out in the US version. It's for shame. But
for shame.
He's nice, but he's also like oppressively like omnipresent. He like owns this woman.
It's the thing where he pushes back less, but it's kind of seems like kind of a confused thing of just like, oh, my wife has straight up not given me friction at all before. I'm processing this right now. This is interesting.
The meanest thing he does is like briefly dismiss her new hobby.
Yes.
Like there's one scene where he
scrunches up.
But like overall, he's like kind of a nice dude. And it's like in Kiki's Delivery Service. If when she went to a new town, everyone was just fucking mean to her, it wouldn't be like as resonant of a film, because then that would be like an easy answer for why she loses her mojo. Like she has to lose her mojo in spite of the entire town being this beautiful idyllic place where everyone loves her and takes care of her. She gets like immediately gets four moms, but she loses her mojo because she's an artist under capitalism.
That's the place where there is interesting friction, though, because in the U.S. version, the obvious thing is to go with the sexy new hotness doctor, and she doesn't. It's interesting because, like, the whole film, like, the film places a lot more emphasis on she has, like, two or three kids. I think there's three kids, but one of them just doesn't come up that much. There's this one guy who one of the guys is he's working for his dad in the mechanic shop, and he's becoming kind of suicidal because he doesn't feel like he's good at being a boy. He doesn't feel like he's good at anything, and he wants to actively pursue being a chef, which is, you know, it's kind of a generic thing of like, oh, I secretly have an artist's soul. I have a feminine touch in my heart. But it's like, it's kind of fun in contrast with how the dad reacts to it, with how the parents react to it, because then you have the more masculine fail son who's just kind of drifting through life, who gets a lot less pushback from the dad for wanting to do nothing in a masculine way, for wanting to go to Tibet with the strange hat girl, strange SJW woman. It's an interesting addition, not because the son himself is particularly interesting, but because it complicates the choice that she has to make. I think that the son is definitely one of the big reasons that she chooses to stay with the husband in the end, in the US version. Because she needs to be an anchor for him.
Mark dwelled a lot more on the mother-son relationship. Stuff is there in the original. There is even implications that one of the sons is getting into cooking.
That's another thing too. Like, that's one thing that was like a little kernel that was planted in that version.
And that remake dualism. What is this like new director scene in the original?
Yeah. We should also mention that the original director of the film, she produced the remake. She was one of the main... Yeah, she was one of the executive producers on the remake. So she did have...
It got her go-ahead.
It got her go-ahead. I don't know if that implies that it was like... That if she... Like, I'm sure that the whatever bag she was getting off that was also an incentive. But, you know, there was some amount of input from her. This was not just like, you know... They didn't, you know, slap Will Ferrell in and put like fucking Grown Ups 2 music over the trailer.
And I think it's so cute when remakes do that. Like Vanilla Sky casting the same person as the girlfriend.
Yeah, that's so cute. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I love that she's in both of them.
Mm-hmm.
I should okay. I have not seen Abre Los Ojos.
Which one's that?
Original Vanilla Sky.
Oh yeah.
I should get on that, because I, like, Vanilla Sky has, like, I watched it because it had, like, the soundtrack is almost entirely MuCore. one of the first songs you hear is Radiohead Kid A.
Yeah, okay, that's the thing I know about it. Yeah, yeah.
Radiohead Kid A is in it. Sigur Rós is in there. There's also like an Radiohead Amnesiac track in there as well.
Remember when dudes were really into Sigur Rós? That was weird. Why'd that happen?
I mean, it's good.
No, it's good. I just don't know why people like it.
Have y'all listened to For a while I was saying their best album is Valtari. I don't know if I still think that. I think I was being contrarian.
Oh boy. You did have contrarian takes for fun at one point in your life.
I think I still do.
Mm-hmm. Like, and I mean, that's fair.
Like, don't you just see like a bunch of people liking something and you're just like, pieces of shit, hate you.
No, this is my art. I made it. I think that I was like really ride or die for Vaughn at one point for some reason.
Oh, I was like fucking. I was the white knight for Sufjan Stevens' "Enjoy Your Rabbit" for so long.
Me too. No, yeah. No, that's a good ass record. That record is like, I feel like that record more than any other Sufjan record is really like the key that unlocks a lot of what he's doing. It's the record, like Age of Az was not a left field change up for him at all. That's something he was working towards naturally for years and years. I don't even think it was really in response to Kid A at all. As much as Kid A really is like a touchstone for a lot of, indie-ish pivot music at
isn't
that point.
Kid A like isn't Kid A just a response to Perdition City?
Yeah.
That's a joke.
Yeah, kind of. It's in response to that like that era of sleaze kind of. It's
actually like they were trying to do their own Aphex Twin moment.
Yeah, yeah.
For some
reason. They were trying to be Aphex Twin, except they made actual songs. I don't know. Enjoy Your Rabbit's really good. Have you heard Ascension yet?
I have not.
That one's really fun. That one feels like kind of like look back memory lane. You get a lot of little like tastes of all of his shit. That's why all of the songs are like 5 minutes long exactly on that record.
Oh, I was also Ride or Die for Seven Swans.
Oh yeah, no, Seven Swans.
I might still be actually.
I'm not gonna argue with you on that.
I good answer. Like, I have not grown out like at all of like the compulsive contrarianism. If something's well liked, I just want to find the niggles in it, and if something's hated, mm-hmm. I want to find the good in it. I'm autistic like that.
I think I'm gonna have like an All Delighted People phase at some point, because that's one of the ones that I bounced off when I dug through it at first. But it's like, I think that the concept of him doing very stupid classic rock stuff is
I'm still Ride or Die for Government Plates. Government Plates is fucking good.
Yeah. Speaking of heavy-handed Christian theming, let's go back to the U.S. version of Puzzle for a minute. One of the last things I wanted to talk about with adaptation between the versions is like specific little things like cultural quirks that were altered between the versions. There's a lot more of Christianity in the U.S.
Puzzle made it into it like a Christianity like versus atheism parable, like Christian woman coming to discover the unending chaotic beauty of life.
It's very Christian in the sense that you have like this temptress, you have this tempting figure who leads her off a path, and through processing this deviation, she's able to come back to and appreciate her normal life more. It's none of it's super subtle. It's like light beaming through windows whenever she starts doing the puzzles. Lots of open air shots with that.
Her looking into like the heavens on the ceiling of Grand Central Station.
Like, yeah. It's
one of the times like she a lot of stuff with her in church.
She's a lot less for as much as she's more agent, it's a lot less present. She's looking back to the past a lot more often. She's okay. The one big change in the U.S. version that I was really astounded by was that at the start of the movie, at her birthday party, her husband breaks a plate on the ground on accident, and she cleans it up, except for one piece that she can't find. In the Argentinian version, there is a scene of her later trying to find the piece under the couch, and they say, "No, don't worry about it. Just leave it there." And in the U.S. version, she towards the end of the film, she's walking around her house and steps on it. And they have this scene where the husband has to pull it out for her. That is, if there's one signifier, big signifier of like the difference in what these two versions are going for, it's definitely in there, in the sense of like.
It's a lot more interested in like aesthetic symmetry, like the piece of glass needs to come back. The puzzle master temptress cannot merely be a promising another life for her. He has to be like a competing ideology. He has to be the atheist who offers her a piece of concrete order and purpose in a chaotic world, like the completing of a puzzle.
Yeah.
It like leans much mm-hmm. harder on that.
He invites her into assessing what she finds interesting about housework in more material terms.
The original has no extended speech about like puzzles being menial tasks that create something aesthetically beautiful.
More blunt in that way, which isn't a bad thing.
It's definitely it's so much more of a chick flick. Like he chick flickified it. He had all of the characters state their thematic significance to the plot. It's to the camera.
I mean, there's worse things you can do in a movie. Yeah. You know, that's not.
And
a
there
bad
are
thing.
Much worse chick flicks as well.
Absolutely, but having that kind of open-ended approach in the original puzzle. Opens up a lot of interesting discussion about agency, about women's labor. There's a lot more stuff to. There's a lot more meaty stuff in the original version, I guess.
Okay.
And it's
before we finish, I want to talk about the other really big change.
Oh,
so
yeah.
If you thought, if you're like one of those 10 people who've seen Puzzle US,
big ups.
You might have thought that it was like a little weird that there's like this scene where the husband tearfully like accuses his wife of having an affair, and she's like autistic as shit and does not know how to reconcile herself with like doing bad things. So she says like, I think. So if
it's like, are you cheating on me? It's like, yeah, yes, I think. Yes, I think I am.
So autistic. But also
she has a
thought that felt like a little weird and like kind of out of place, how it just kind of disappears, and then they just have the triumphant like puzzle competition scene where she's like girl bossing on all the puzzlers. And then it's just never brought up again. That's because in the original, the husband just never finds out.
Yes.
He remains oblivious for the entire movie. And
I wish that the husband...
It's not even really a big thing that happens.
I wish that the husband was given, like, a little bit more interiority if his reaction to her cheating was going to be made more of a priority in this version, you know? Like if he's going to be much more prescient in the film, if even the thing where like, okay, that's another thing between the two that kind of changes a little bit. In the original, in both versions, the husband is giving a little nonsense thing that he also cares about, that you could kind of imagine him introspecting on a little bit more after his wife starts spending less time with her. In the original, it was Tai Chi. And in the American version, it was fishing. And we do get a lot more time spent on this second property where the husband in the US version goes fishing. It could have been fun. Such a beautiful man. It could have been fun to have, like, because I don't know, we get like these shots of him talking to his bros at the start of the movie, who are pretty much treated as extras with no dialogue. I want like a little bit more from him if he's going to be because
that's the big difference between these films. In the original, it's not really a problem that the husband isn't a character because it's such a tiny movie with such a tiny idea. It's a very like basic small story with like just illustrating this one feminist parable about a woman who is offered a new life but simply cannot because she's trapped in her life.
That's not to say the husband feels like a non-person in that film either, though. He's definitely present. It definitely feels like he's lived a full life up to that point. He's just definitely he's made secondary.
But it's like less of a flaw that he's not, that he doesn't have interiority.
Yes.
Because the US version is so much more about characters. Like it's actually like about these two men almost, and because we have the stable, predictable Christian man, and we have the unstable,
whorish,
like fucked up, chaotic, atheist man.
Very rich, big, sexy hotness, who upends.
Because he has
upends her moral belief simply. Not by the way he lives, but just by him existing. By him being an option where, oh, I don't have to live the way I do if I go with
for
this.
Him, like, him being an option. Him, like, also... The US remake also gives him the trait of watching news all the time and, like, talking about horrible natural disasters that are going on all over
really
the world.
Really funny running bit of every time Kelly McDonald goes to his house, he's just like, there was a horrible mudslide in India. 50 people are going to get buried. It's terrible. I was watching it on the news right there, and he points to his TV. It's
incredibly
really
good. Because, like, it is more chick flicky. They have to, like, make him alluring. It's not merely that he's a new exciting reprieve that he doesn't mm-hmm. simply represent her her self-actualization. He is a hot, sexy, rich man who like offers her something.
If they wanted to, he needed to meet the additional focus on the son with an additional focus on the husband's reaction to it. I think that's the core of it for me, because like that's the 20 minutes that kind of drags, of like her going in and being like, actually, you've been mean to me, and then the husband just kind of sitting there like a wet rag. He's not given enough to do. And that's
he like has no more lines after that scene.
He's just kind of and you do get some good conflicts with that. Like they set up a good US version exclusive conflict where they talk about they have a conversation about wanting to sell the secondary fishing property, and then they don't talk about it again, and the husband just kind of brings up at dinner one day where it's like, yeah, your wife and I decided to sell the property without consulting her any further. So it's this thing where he has to process how he did the thing that she asked of him, but he is still kind of in the wrong because he didn't consult her further. He's still, you know, kind of demeaning his input.
There is a subtle through line of him like taking credit. I also like that in the original, she actually like says no to him. She says no to the puzzle meister. She can't go with him to Belgium. In the original, it's Belgium, I think. In the remake, we have this like fucking horrible scene where she's just like out with her family, and then her sexy puzzle meister calls her like, oh, are you ready to like go to Germany? And she's like, oh no.
It's heartbreaking, and it doesn't really feel like it's like, it's so weird. It's weird. It feels more icky the more I think
about
it. Yeah, it's like,
like she can't.
There's some gestures, especially there's like more gestures in the original version that he was kind of a womanizer. He probably wouldn't have treated her like exceptionally well as a husband. But like, it's not enough for that to feel like, not even triumphant, just like something that I feel comfortable with leaving. You know, walking out of the theater.
I think it
got stuck in my craw.
I will like make the tentative. I think their chemistry was better in the original. They have that like that part in Ad Astra where Amicus takes you out to like spar on the island, and then he pins you to the ground and like kisses you in a moment of passion. There's like a moment like where they're like doing a puzzle together, and like they're so gassed, they're in such a good mood, and then like the puzzle meister like just leans over and kisses her. And
there's a lot of good moments of passion with the puzzle meister in both versions.
Yeah.
Like these would have worked on me.
I
see why he saw a chick flick, and I see why Turtle Top saw a chick flick.
Yeah.
Because there's a lot of stuff that would have worked on me. There's a lot of like, oh, I'm sorry I did that. I'll stop if you want.
in terms of like, even though like I do like fall like on preferring the original by a bit, I do like respect. Like I do think it's like a good adaptation. Like that Mark saw a chick flick in this and made it into one.
It makes a lot of sense. It's incredible how well it translates, honestly.
Like it translates well enough that neither of us, like both of us, were blindsided by the information that this was a remake.
yeah absolutely. It felt like when I watched this for the first time in an AMC theater in bumfuck nowhere, New Jersey, I sat down, saw what was like a nice kind of heady chick flick type movie, and walked out feeling satisfied. And I feel like that's a testament to the remake. I think they did good with it.
It's like, even if it was different. Like localized. It's very well localized remake. There is one scene that is just before we go. One scene. Both movies have like the scene where they communicate, oh, now the wife is in a good mood because she like found a special interest and like she's self-actualizing for the first time in her life. In the original, she like has her little feet in a little foot bath, and she splishy splashes them, and it's so cute. It's so cute.
It's so cute. So cute.
In
She's great.
In the new one, in the U.S. version, upon my third watch, I saw they have the foot bath. It's she is like taking a foot bath, but she does not go splishy splash. She like overhears the conversation, and she does like echolalia to it because she's autistic as shit. Like they say transformative, and she's like, oh, that's a good transformative, which like it is autistic as shit.
Yeah, she is taking a foot bath in that scene.
Yeah, she is taking a foot bath, but she does not go splishy splash. 0 out of 10.
shit movie.
Terrible.
You'll never work in Hollywood again, Turtle Top. Fuck you.
Jacob.
Hi, Jacob.
Jacob Collier. Instead with the cadence of Nickelodeon.
We need to stop recording. I haven't listened to the new SZA record yet. We need to get on that before judging Jacob Collier's music.
Like that's like
what a fuck what a fuck
like
up
that's
man.
That's the thing. Like I heard that he did like backing vocals on a SZA track, and like I listened to it, and I'm like, no, he didn't. That's not a real person. They got like AI to do like I know that he's a real guy who exists. But like when I try and think about him, like in a room with another musician making music with them, it doesn't compute. Like he's friend.
he occupies like a Hatsune Miku esque place in my mind, where he's just got, where I can listen to a Jacob Collier track and I'll be like, oh, that was good, Jacob Collier. But I don't really process it. It's like, you know,
he's so on the new Coldplay record as well. He's fucking friends with Chris Martin.
Okay, we got it. Okay, tell me who Jacob Collier is.
Jacob Collier is a himbim. Jacob Collier smashed onto the scene with a couple fucking like astounding Stevie Wonder covers where he's playing all the music himself, and Reddit was like, whoa. Because whoa is the only like emotion that Reddit can process, like that's the only one they like. Whoa,
Jacob Collier is a very Stop Wars type musician. I think.
Did you hear that part in the fucking Moon River, like where he's like, oh, these two chords, you know, they're like people with opposing views,
and they're two separate worlds, but they can both coexist, just like people of opposing political beliefs. You have C major and E major, but they're both really content being who they are, but they agree, they sometimes agree on some stuff, and that's the stuff you need to endorse. But it's really fun to do that.
They find
okay,
common ground.
Yeah, the Moon River live stream was a good, like a good
primer.
It was a good primer for a lot of this of like, okay.
I'll continue the story.
I'm gonna have to go
because I was.
Yeah, just go.
So he smashed onto the scene with these Stevie Wonder covers, and also, then made a huge splash on like music theory YouTube after like he did like a couple interviews, with this fella Jun Lee, who like transcribes music for fun, and. He had this way of like saying to a lot of people, he seemed to be like translating these huge ass musical concepts into like very digestible forms, and he like popularized a lot of like music theory things that people started making music theory videos about, like negative harmony was like he popularized that, and I must agree, this is like my dark secret. Jacob Collier has had more influence on my songwriting than like any musician ever, probably. I utilize his theory of like harmonic dualism, like so, it's in me at this point. I think about super hyper mega meta Lydian scales all the time, entirely too many times. But like negative harmony is less complicated than it sounds. It's like, well, you start with the kind of nerdy sounding idea that if you flip a chord about a key's axis, that you'll get something with the same harmonic function. But like what Jacob Collier could translate that and just say, like, well, everything major becomes minor and everything perfect becomes plagal. And okay, now it's in terms that I can understand, like a minor four add six resolving to the one has exactly the same weight as a dominant seventh resolving to the one, but like just from the dark side, from the dark side of the moon, from the other side of the circle of it's so fucking cool. I love him.
He has a great YouTube presence.
So that's
the start with me, is he's great speaking presence and everything I've seen from him. I 100% get why he is like popular YouTube personality person.
Easy to watch. So then he made like a debut album. Like being like kind of able to understand what he's doing, it is a fucking enthralling listen, even if it sounds like elevator music. it's like
that's in my room.
Yes,
right?
In my room. It is like okay. It's the pop version of like a Dream Theater album, essentially. Like stratospherically technical, most boring fucking music you will ever listen to in your life. So then.
That's the other thing that's I'm approaching Jacob Collier from, is that I know him as YouTube personality who's good at making YouTube videos, and also the worst musician I've ever listened to. I think he's evil.
After all this attention he's been getting, he decided, okay, what if I made an album that was just every genre? What if I did all the music? And thus begins the Jesse saga that I made Patrick listen to. What was your first impression of Jesse, Patrick?
Yeah, you know, I'm just going to have like an African song, and I'm going to have like an orchestra song. I'm going to make all the types of music. It's going to be awesome. It's going to... Okay. All right. Okay, I need to quantify my shit a bit. I need to quantify. It's lib shit, but I don't hate lib shit on principle. I think a lot of what I consume in my day-to-day life could be easily classified as lib shit. You know, I think I don't think there's that much fundamentally different from listening to Jacob Collier and me watching a fantastic YouTube channel, Jetlag the Game. It's... You know, like, I don't think there's anything intrinsically wrong with what he's trying to do mechanically. And that's what's very frustrating to me.
You don't think there...
okay, well, there is, okay. But it's not like...
Okay, I'm getting the name of the song before I say that line. You can cut this out.
I think that Every Little Thing She Does Is Magic cover is the most successful part of volume one.
Don't think there's anything wrong with the record scratch on Dun Dun Baba?
I think there's so much wrong with that. I think there's so much wrong with that, but I understand what
I think.
Like,
I think that's
the
like
impetus
the worst
to do that
sound
with.
I've ever heard in a song.
okay. Off the top, with this being the first part of like an album series, you were saying that there was some shit. Okay, Jesse is an album cycle that is ongoing that has three volumes out right now. There's thematic ties between the parts, but I'm still really having trouble getting my head around how it's a series. The first one is 53 minutes long. The second one is 70 minutes long. And the third one is 40 minutes long. Just reading that out, I don't know. It feels like something horrible has gone wrong when I think about these things. And then I put on the first album, and It opens with two separate, like, 4 minute long orchestral interlude tracks that take up about a fifth of the runtime before you get into any of the actual fucking music. It's definitely a first album in something that he wanted to be very okay. ambitious.
So,
Talk to me about the divisions with these volumes.
I think it's really cool. It's by size. Okay. So the first one is outdoor spaces. So that's the orchestra album. It's the big band album. It's the like Moroccan hand percussion album. It's the choral album.
Got you. Okay.
And,
okay.
Second album is volume two is indoors. And that one is very wide reaching because that's why it has like the big a cappella moment. It's the folk album. It's the funk album. There's a rock moment. There's like a very smoky nightclub R&B moment. It has a very pity that the chamber strings moment is so short. Lua is actually one of my favorite songs in the whole project.
No, that one's pretty good.
That's like his bossa nova thing also fits into like the room size. And then volume three is negative space. So that's the electronic one.
Okay. Volume three, I liked front to back. That is a hot take. One of the project. Yeah, talk to me about that. Talk to me about the Collier fan base.
I mean,
what was their response to this?
The Collier fan base thinks he can do no wrong, is the thing. Like, so
okay, but like in terms of worse of a good thing,
it doesn't exist. Collier fans are mostly other musicians who I idolize him.
Okay.
So he has no bad songs. It's impossible.
Okay, go a step further down then. Tell me about what made Volume 3 less... For more of the passive Collier fan. Because this was the only one where I felt like he wrote, like, songs and orchestrated songs. Because, like... Okay, you saying that about the scope with it is interesting. Because I was wondering what the tie between Moroccan hand percussion and the orchestral shit that it kept cutting back to was. And I guess that makes sense. But still, like, a lot of Everlasting Motion feels like hard cuts between a cool field recording that he took and a separate song that he spent a lot of time writing somewhere else. Like, that does not feel like something that he, like... That doesn't feel like a song. May your love shine through the deepest, darkest moments. May your smile bring light to my deepest, darkest ocean. May your love. Yeah, critically poor, like arranging skills on this man. Okay. Yeah. But volume three, that one felt like songs front to back. Those felt like songs I could listen to. Yeah,
songs okay, go, go, go. I could listen to.
You know, not that intense, but you know what I mean.
So yes, he got like the sequencing on volume one, like the structuring of the songs is like critical. It's incontinent.
Deranged.
So the reason With the Love in My Heart doesn't sound like any other track on the album is that that's supposed to be like the overture for the entire project after the other two overtures.
Come the fuck, dude.
So that's why.
That's a third of the album. You made three intro songs to your 9-song album, dude.
And so that's why it doesn't have like a point. It's just like 20,000 funk excursions layered on top of each other, and like now that I've listened to it about 10,000 times, like to try and study it, like dissect it and look inside of it, I think there is something there that he's doing with the structures. Like there's two sides that he's going back and forth between, and they like kind of meld more and more over, like they meld more and more over the course of the track length. But then, like, they kind of come together in that, like horrible fucking trap breakdown. And then like, it climaxes in this thing that did not register to me as a climax because it's, like, such a limp fart of a funk moment. Where he has this, like, Dilla groove. And the it's a massive preset. Those synths going, wah, wah. Put it in. Put it. That is a massive preset. I watched the making of, because I've studied everything this man has put out into the universe. And then there's, like, the ambient outro that takes up two-thirds of the song, seems to just come out of nowhere, like, just dead stops. And then it...
You know, just vibing. I just kind of want to end the song on vibes,
and
you know?
It can't go anywhere, so it just kind of, like, starts building up again and then fades out. Atrocious.
Again, very wet
atrocious
fart.
Song. So he did, like, get better at arranging over time.
Yeah, Volume 2 is notably better than Volume 1.
Yeah. Volume 2 is my favorite, actually.
I like it more. I don't know. I think that there were a lot more talented people involved in this one as part of it for me. Like, you know, I did get the Leanne LaHavas jump scare, which is always fun to have.
Like, I was going into it, like, I thought this was Jacob Collier attempting to make every genre. And as soon as Volume 3 hits, it just becomes clear that he has exclusively heard pop music and Flying Lotus.
Yeah, this guy watched the clip of Questlove talking about J Dilla, and his mind was fucking blown wide open. And he never has heard a hip hop song in his life.
He raps on this one.
He does. He does white boy rapping on it.
Patrick told me that it sounds like a Patricia Taxon song, and I have never
Count the People is a Patricia Taxon song.
I have never been so insulted in my life.
Come alive, come alive, keep it up on us, humanize, enterprise. Governize, stabilize, revolutionize, polarize, sympathize. Everything is all right, stop right, moonlight, now I'm gonna make it right. Speaking up there, catch you on the way, gonna freak out, set the world alight, give me some of that. Luminosity, reciprocity, living like a honeybee, never sting that. Typically, animosity is never gonna set you free when you like that. My reality is like an apple tree, gonna fruit drop, guarantee that. But I'm never gonna cut that generosity from the slack, when it's ripped off, gonna get back, wiggle.
You could, like, this was before you told me about you getting influenced by him too. You could literally clip Count the People out and put it on Gloria, and it would have fit in there.
Thanks for saying that to me.
You're your best friend.
You're
I like that song. That's a good ass song.
He does a fucking Chance the Rapper. But
yeah, it's good. It's cute.
I have mixing issues with this album. I don't think this man can mix. He's not a good producer. Right. Like, when All I Need came out, I was like, I kind of liked it in terms of songwriting, but I don't know what he did to make it sound like that. Like, one of the singers will make an S sound, and I will be obliterated instantly. Like, I'm trying to get into it, but then, like, the chorus hits, and it's just shh, shh, shh. And, like, when he released it, he said, like, oh, that, like, for a bit, like, With the Love in My Heart was the one with the most tracks in the session, like. And you can hear, because it has like 700 fucking tracks.
This is Screenshot the DAW music.
It is Screenshot the DAW music. But then, like, he's like, All I Need apparently broke that record and has like 800 tracks. And my first thought was, bitch, where are they?
That's just a song. That's straight up just a song.
And if you watch his producer live stream, it's because he layers his synths like an EDM tutorial YouTuber. Like, every pad has like 15 fucking layers of, like,
man.
Jacob. Okay, fellas, heart to heart, EDM producer to EDM producer, you do not need to layer your synths as much as EDM producer YouTube, like, wants you to. That is a ploy to, like, it's a ploy to, like, sell hard drives, I think. Like, because all it does is waste CPU.
there's That's a great song too. Like, I do like that song a lot. I think that's the I think like a couple years back you linked me that track and was like, "Here's Jacob Collier," and I was like, "Cool."
Did you notice when it modulated to a half key?
A little bit.
There is a quarter tone modulation in All I Need.
That's cute. I mean, like, on the, when you get to Volume 3, you've got like big collab you throughout this record. You've got fucking Kimbra, you've got T-Pain, you've got friend of the program Ty Dolla $ign, you got like it's like
And he, okay, ex arguably except for Ty Dolla $ign, he wastes all of them. Let me just say,
Kimbra was kind of fun. I liked Kimbra.
I think he should be canceled for how he used Rhapsody. Like that's the thing. Like, that's why I can't consider Jacob Collier to be like truly a musical prodigy, is because the rate at which this man wastes his collaborators is just astounding. He wasted Steve Vai. He
I'm less enthusiastic about him than you, but I understand like the agony of wanting to be more contrarian about somebody than you can be. Because like I can feel it when you're talking about him, how desperately you want to be contrarian about this man. It's clawing and biting and scratching and
he made the fucking Metropole Orchestra sound like a contact library. Just abysmally produced orchestra. I hate modern orchestra like production. I hate contrabass is not sub. It is not. Stop using it like it's a sub. Like in the fucking like YMS video when he's talking about Lion King and he's like, "Oh, actually, like Hans Zimmer released a remixed and remastered edition of the Lion King soundtrack in 2015." And then he plays them side by side and the new one just sucks so much. It's
Kill,
so
huh?
like I part of me dies when he transitions from the original soundtrack to the new
Speaking of
one.
Hans Zimmer. Do you want to talk about his wall of beautiful friends that he loves to call on the telephone? Do you... the one song with, that I got linked the producer breakdown for was Moon River, which
Moon
is a
River.
cover of Moon River.
The thing with Moon River. Okay, you go first.
No, yeah, that again, first time I've heard Jacob talk for an extended period of time. He was just going through his phone at one point saying, "Yeah, you know, I was really into the like, you know, the idea of like a moon that was also a river. So I called up all of my good friends."
To just talk you through how this whole thing worked, because it was a really surreal experience, the whole thing. But the first thing I did for Moon River is I had an idea, and all the best things start with having an idea. And my idea was, I wanted to ask lots of different people to send me moons, send me their own moon videos, from wherever they were in the world, friends and Jesse collaborators from around the globe. And I wanted to make this great big collage of moons, which was a little ambitious, to be frank.
And he's just going through like fucking like again, one of them is Ty Dolla $ign, one of them is Hans Zimmer, just a bunch of just this like nightmarish mix of like
And I received moon after moon after moon, 150 moons in total. It was a really extraordinary experience, and they're from all sorts of different kinds of people. Here is, there you go. There's Chris Martin, my friend. He's in a band called Coldplay. Here's David Crosby. What a legend. Amazing. Here's Mr. Caesar. Not bad in the slightest. That's a G. Very nice. I appreciate that. Jonah from Jelly Loops. Kimbra, one of my favorite artists in the whole world. She was actually my Spotify artist of the decade, Kimbra, funnily enough. Jules Buckley, the conductor of the Metropole Orchestra. Smash. Leanne Le Havas. Man, this is wonderful. There's Charlie Puth. Quincy Jones. Ty Dolla $ign. Tori Kelly.
Steve Vai sent him a video of him just like in his studio, like this professional shot, and it opens with a fade in. And Jacob Collier notes like the fade in as being such a classy move by Steve Vai. I hope it was Steve Vai.
Steve Vai.
Moon.
And what I appreciate the most about Steve Vai's moon is just the crossfade. That is so classy. So if you ever send a moon to somebody, do it with a crossfade. Thank you.
And he arranges them. He takes all of these recordings of very expensive people singing one note, and uses them to make 3 or 4 minute introduction to this a cappella piece that he was making. When I listen to Jacob Collier, as I have recently in my life, I'm gonna say the thing that I also said it privately to other people. I feel like Jacob is inviting me over to his house, and he's made me, you know, a big bowl of chili, maybe a large soup, something to that effect, something that you have to work on for a little while, something there's a large quantity of. He hands me a bit, he pours me a big scoop of the chili. I take a bite of the chili, and I say, oh, there's nutmeg in this. I've never had a chili with like this prominent of a nutmeg flavor before in my life. When I look up from my bowl, Jacob has like a really big grin on his face, and he says, can you guess what my secret ingredient is? Like, I want there to be a point where it stops being gimmicky bullshit. And there's really small moments where it does, you know?
Yeah, the thing with Moon River, like, especially, like, listening to it, watching that live stream, there's, like, a part of my composer brain that lights up like a firework to this song.
Neuron activation.
Because the harmony, it's never just harmony. Like, it's all melody. Like,
it's insane.
These stratospheric skyscrapers that he's, like, painting, and all of them have voices, like, smoothly, like, going through them, and then he presses play on the YouTube upload, and it's just the worst fucking thing you've ever heard in your life. Like, it's like inarguably one of the most disagreeable aesthetic experiences you can have with a piece of audio.
I heard that, like, there's the part with the bubble sound effects in the live stream. He's like, I bet you didn't notice the bubble sounds I put in here. Yes, I did. I really super did.
Oh, dream. This is the one bit in the arrangement that is not a cappella. There are two sounds that you need to know about. Here's the first one. And here's the second one. I bet you didn't notice that before. And that is bubbles and chimes of goodness. And it's really unconscious, but I knew I needed a little bit of icing, so I did that.
Oh, dream.
It's fucking even, like, agonizing.
And even then, like, there are individual changes in there that, like, give me fucking, like, chills, like, when I think about them. Like on a song, I will, like, give you the timestamp after we're done, so you can put it in.
I'm gonna need a lot of timestamps for this one, Queen. I'm sorry. Thank you.
It's just so tender and beautiful and, like, unexpected, and but also, like, the only way it could ever be. And there's this fucking immense, like, escalation at the end that makes me, like, shiver to think about, where, yeah, like, he's crescendoing, and also the tune is slowly going up. I normally do not notice Jacob Collier's microtonal bullshit, because he's doing it in the just intonation way, where it's like more in tune than in tune.
Yeah, I've never had a problem with the microtonal stuff. He does that.
All of his thirds are 5/4, like, hugging thirds.
There's always a point to that. Yeah,
but this Moon River cover is the most noticeable it's ever been, because every new chord is just a little, like, unexpectedly bright. And it just keeps going and going, and, like, still with that property of it all being melodies. It's all, like, billions of little. It's the worst fucking song ever made. It's so bad. It's so fucking bad.
I've been staring at the Volume 2 cover for a little bit. It's making me upset.
Kids don't even say trick-or-treat anymore. They just stare at you like this.
I was gonna say that. God damn it. He's got the fluoride stare. He's got...
Have you seen that Innuendo Studios video about Phil Fish?
Oh yeah, I have seen that one.
His like first video where he knocked it out of the park right away.
Good video.
Incredible video. Phil Fish is guilty of the crime of being famous wrong. Jacob Collier is guilty of the crime of being talented wrong. Like people simply cannot comprehend that someone this gifted could have the worst taste someone could possibly have.
SZA needs to lock him in her dungeon. She can never let him out.
Like, she should lock him in her dungeon and just make him listen to, like, The Miseducation of Lauryn Hill or something.
Please,
like,
God. Like... Please, find God, come back to me.
let him hear one hip-hop song.
Please.
And
I don't think it'll take that much. Like, I think he just needs to listen to like a Far Side record.
I'm gonna like read out. Is this review still there? I need to read out a rate. Okay, I'm sorry for singling out this guy, but this is the primest example of Jacob Collier's haters being very normal. Rate your music user writes. With regards to All I Need, the song, the single, I am so very insecure. I cannot write good music. I can't learn music theory properly, and my fingers are too weak to play bar chords. Thus, Jacob Collier's mediocre, middle-of-the-road pop music absolutely infuriates me. Why, Jacob? All the talent and knowledge in the world, and you write this? This is the most overproduced background music soulless shit I have ever listened to. This is Starbucks music. A simple synth group with high-pitched vocals annoyingly juxtaposing themselves against the music before an admittedly nice transition to the chorus, which sounds horrifically generic, coffee shop jazz. The song then flounders without direction after the chorus, highlighting how boring the groove on the song is. Synth funk, in scare quotes, because this has absolutely no funk to it. Jacob Collier displays that he truly is not a human on this song. He is a robot. He writes extraordinary music when he tries, but this doesn't even have that, does it? I think the whole piece is in 4/4. Sorry. Switching between E-flat and B-flat the entire time. This doesn't work as art music, and due to how horrifically boring it is, it doesn't work as pop music. Collier is a robot, despite all the knowledge and talent an artist could ever want. There is one thing he will never have. A soul. Yeah, Collier haters are like really confidently call this man like a psychopath.
Yeah, this is I don't like that. That's weird.
Like, there's this horrible, like, vitriol, like how
While we're quote tweeting this specific rando on Rate Your Music, I see they have Pere Ubu listed in their favorite artist, which do use two chords per song at most. There's never been a Pere Ubu song with more than two chords in it.
But. Like,
it's that's weird.
His,
I don't like
his
that.
Hate base are like so, like, either angry that this man is so good at music and yet he makes the worst music imaginable, because, like, oh, if I was that talented, I would make something fucking immense.
Yeah.
Watch this CJ the X video, motherfucker. But also, there's the other side where they see him sucking as like vindication for them hating music theory.
Yeah, and
like look at this guy.
And as a moral failing, like, I don't think that him not being able to write songs most of the time, I don't think it indicates anything about him as a person. I just think it's funny. Because that's the thing with Volume 3, though, is because that's the, like, that's the closest he's been able to tap into, like, a vein properly. Like, there is, like, a proper, like, 80s sleaze sophistic pop vein to this. I don't know. I feel like if he's going to continue to do this route of, like, the super layered million different takes pop music, this is where he should be channeling that effort and not, like, weird voyeuristic, like... Paprika Plains ass like African like, drum music things. I don't know.
I think he's a good guy.
No, yeah, he seems nice.
Like he does not have like I think a lot of like the people accusing him of being smarmy, I think they're projecting.
Yeah.
His fan base on the other hand are the smarmiest motherfuckers on earth.
Like, yeah, okay, I want to clarify that when I say he's good, yeah, when he's good at making smarmy 80s music, that does not mean that he's smarmy. The faux 80s music, like, you know, the YouTube
I think Jacob doesn't really have
a good genre name yet.
I think Jacob himself is actually very humble.
Yeah.
And he's like gotten like more like modest with his songwriting as he's gotten older.
I think that Volume 3 is a good album.
Okay.
I
believe you. I don't know. I hate the production.
That's fair. That's
like,
fair.
The production is all bad.
I need to make you listen to Prefab Sprout at some point before we continue this. Because
okay.
I have a whole thing about 80 sleaze.
There was something that when I was talking about like how he always wastes his collaborators, like we cannot finish the podcast without mentioning how this motherfucker used Take Six.
Yeah. Who are Take Six? I'm not aware of these guys.
Okay, Take Six are an a cappella group.
They've been around for a while. Oh, fuck.
They've been around for a while. Their debut album, their self-titled album, one of the greatest albums ever made. I was not expecting to be able to like sit through an entire album of a cappella jams, especially because a lot of them are like retelling Bible stories in like a very like quirky jazzy way, but it's so rich, it's so fucking rich. Like if you're gonna listen to anything, listen to like Take Six Goldmine, and like listening to them, like it kind of like made me realize like that's where Jacob got the acapella, his acapella chops from. Like his mom
put that on in the car for sure.
Yeah, he's when he does acapella stuff, he's definitely trying to do the Take Six thing, but he's so much worse. And like hearing like the source material kind of like made me realize how much worse he is at it. like for one, it's in the 80s and it's before they decided to just overproduce a cappella music to shit, so like it sounds like listenable, like they're in a room and they're all singing. And also there's six of them, which
yes.
Like why is the what benefit do we get from, well, they're a live ensemble, so like there you can't have just the same guy and it's like the fucking 70s or whatever. But also it's because there's different voices
yeah.
in the chords.
Yeah.
And it sounds rich and beautiful. And also everyone is like in their best range. Jacob Collier's range is like a solid baritone, but he attempts to cover the entire vocal spectrum anyways.
It's charming when he does like the falsetto and it's really deep down in the mix, but when he moves when anything outside of that baritone range is like the forefront of a song, it can be difficult.
It's because he sings every song like he's one of 100 of him, like he makes his voice into a sine wave. like he wants to take up as little harmonic information as possible.
It's the thing that I don't like in YTPMVs, where they just take like an isolated, where it's like, oh yeah, I recreated this song using SpongeBob samples, but it's just like, you just made a sine wave. You just made a really roundabout sine wave. Andrew Wong call out.
You didn't make a song out of a like air conditioner. That's just white noise that you can isolate any frequency out of. So Take Six appear on that Lionel Richie cover on All Night Long.
Yes.
Could you hear anything?
No.
Could
tell that men were singing.
Was there any evidence that they're that the greatest vocal ensemble to perform?
he has a lot of reverence for them too. Like he was talking in the live stream, was like, yeah, these are like. These guys are so inspirational to me.
He passed the time trying to be the seventh Take Six member alone in his house.
Yes, it's something that he clearly cares a lot about, and I don't
and,
know.
And he relegated like, them to just doing the, All Night. That's them. They're doing the All Night.
Really? Like,
yeah,
is that
that's
it?
Them. It's All Night. You can play that too.
All night long, all night.
That is the contribution.
Crazy. I straight up thought they were somebody else on the song. That's so fucked up.
That should have gotten him canceled.
Yeah, that's really bad. That's the
ninth arch sin.
I want to talk about Jesse as a cultural project for a minute before we wrap up too, because. Okay. I don't know, like, again, going back to what made Volume 3 stand out, the first two volumes kind of rub me the wrong way, in the same way that all, like, it feels like ideologically adjacent to New Age as a movement, like, New Age, like...
Oh, it's more explicit than that, because he, like, every time he, like... focuses super hard on whatever tenuous like connection he can build, like mm-hmm. like the Moroccan hand percussion on Everlasting Motion are eventually subsumed into a J Dilla beat.
Yeah,
that's
which
how
is,
that
which is
ends.
So head ass. First it's... of all,
isn't it like kind of similar? Like yeah, like know... how like two cultures independently came up with the idea of not playing perfectly on time.
It's a good thing me, Jacob Collier, was able to finally find the progression point through 500 years of capital B capital A black art. It's great. It's so great. But I want to dig into it a little bit, because like the way that I was originally able to understand this project, I was listening to it, was through the lens of like musical theater. There's like it's a very like Little Mermaid ass album. At its best moments, like every little thing she does is magic cover. That's the one that I keep coming back to on the first one, because that feels like
Also, since it's a cover, it's like the only song on the album that has structuring.
But I don't know. I think that what he's doing with the cultural exchange there feels like the most interesting and kind of tucked away, because, you know, the police, you know, the police's whole thing is like, okay, it's white guys kind of adapting reggae, like elements of reggae into their pop music, and that gives them a distinct sound. So pushing that back, that feels like there is like an actual narrative that's forming there. And in the context of musical theater more broadly, what we think of as the musical theater sound is the result of a lot of cultural exchange throughout the early 1900s in the East Coast, most notably between Jewish musicians and black musicians. So I don't think he's overstepping culturally as much as it seems like when he goes in and does these things. There's nothing wrong inherently with what he's attempting to do here from that perspective, but there's just something about it, and it might be the lack of songwriting chops, and it might just be the way that everything is eventually drowned in the mix by everything else, but it's like it feels weirdly ahistoric in a way that most musical theater stuff doesn't. Because when you think about, like, I don't know, like Rhapsody in Blue or Porgy and Bess or something like that, it's like, that's all culture. Like, the whole thing with those projects is culture. And it's viewing one culture through another culture's lens. It's blowing that up into a massive scale. And it's delicate, but it's something that does feel like a finished piece of art in a way that most of Jacob's songs really don't, because there's just so much fucking shit. It's so, like, there's so much that's obfuscated. There's so much that's like, I don't know. Like, it feels like he doesn't cite his sources. It feels like he's drawing from nowhere. Like, if you say, yeah, this is the Moroccan song, that doesn't tell me anything. If you say this is the Celtic song, that doesn't tell me anything.
It's not even the Moroccan song. It's the noticing the wonky rhythm in Moroccan hand percussion,
much like to think about,
noticing that Like, that's the one observation he has.
And it doesn't even fit, because the whole thing with drum machines is that they were readily available at the time, and the instrument only to a select group of people, and the Moroccan hand instruments, those are, that's not like, I don't think there's like a strong of a class divide with their use in Moroccan. It's just not really an interesting thought, and it becomes less interesting the more that Jacob meddles with it. I don't know. It just doesn't get there for me,
so,
I guess.
So
I hope he stays in his goddamn lane. I can't.
We return to the single solitary record scratch on Dun Dun Baba.
Yeah. Yeah. It always comes back to it.
Worst.
Does it signify really early hip hop culture? Does it signify new metal? Does it signify an actual physical phonograph that's changing out two records on a record player? Am I supposed to interpret this as being a big shift in the song, or is this supposed to be a unifying thing in the sense that a DJ is fusing two songs together?
Are we supposed to see it as like a point of cultural connection, or is it a vile intrusion?
Yeah, is this disruption or is this incorporation? I'm sure I could have interesting conversations with Jacob about all of these things, but all of that
I want to pick his brain apart so bad.
But all of it's outside the record. All of it's outside the record, and that's what's so frustrating about it to me.
I want to be Jacob Collier's best friend. I could.
Jacob, come on the podcast.
Come on the podcast.
Jacob. Hello. I said mean things about you. I'm sorry. I also want to be friends with Leanne LaHavis. If you could hook me up with her, I want to go to a museum with her, and we could point at paintings together. Fucking Ty Dolla $ign, come on the podcast. Ty Dolla $ign, you've been putting in a lot of good work on a lot of what we've talked about on here.
You are prominent
Life of Pablo MVP.
Best part of All I Need.
Mm-hmm.
And like remains the best used feature that Jacob Collier has ever employed. And he says like the Ty Dolla $ign just did whatever the hell he wanted on that track.
Yes. Thank you, sir.
Do you have anything to plug?
Oh yeah, I have plugs. Okay. I redid my website recently. Go check out my website. I've got new shit up on there. I'm keeping a regularly updated page for my visual art now. So you could click on those for, like, I guess more major things. My boyfriend started a Patreon, if you're into, like, cooking. And, like, I think he's going to be doing fursuit stuff on there, too. Definitely give that a look. He has a lot of good recipes and food stories up on there already.
Will he be posting the Cy Twombly shit on there?
No, that's going to be free online forever.
Okay.
Go check out his page, too. Do you have anything to plug?
Play Spring Collab first if you've never played a Celeste mod in your life. Like, Spring Collab first until you hit a difficulty wall, then switch to Strawberry Jam. Because Spring Collab, you know, in that video, I very confidently say it's always interesting, even as it's not always palatable. Strawberry Jam is always palatable, sometimes interesting, and also they didn't have a limit on how long you can make the maps this time around, so some of them do overstay their welcome. So for that reason, I do believe Spring Collab is the better entry point still, as much as the community would harshly disagree with me on that. If you're gonna play Strawberry Jam, just play the beginner lobby. Because after that, the meta kicks in, and then, like, it's not as fun. And a lot of, like, the most interesting stuff is in the beginner lobby.
The story of my lifetime. Pain and steel and pain and mother. Bada, your dirty mother. Look how far we are. Okay.